Three, personal finance. Here we are, our fifth and last video in this series on insurance. And as you already know from the title, in this video we look at the very important topic of health insurance. This is one that we all got to talk about. This is crucially important for each one of us because we're all human, which means that eventually our bodies are going to need care and attention. So you can see from the title slide, health insurance, lecture number 5. Let's talk about health insurance. Well, hey, this is a topic that touches every single one of us eventually. So I don't think I need to tell you, in a world of this COVID pandemic, be thankful for every healthy day that you're given, every day that you are vertical and not under the care of a medical professional is a good day. That's not true for everyone, though, as you very well know, right? Many of us have loved ones, have friends, and some of us have just come out from having to have some pretty extended care. And sometimes having extended medical care leaves an anchor around our neck, known as medical debt. Medical debt is still a big burden, right? Just because you're out of the hospital or out of the emergency room doesn't mean you don't have a financial obligation you've incurred. The data suggests that about 1/3 of working Americans have some level of outstanding medical debts. 1/3 of working Americans. Some of it small, some of it not so small. Of those with medical debt, almost a half of them owe over $5,000, which they'll have to slowly pay off, right? For most folks, our budgets don't allow us to instantly reroute $5,000 to pay off medical debt because of something that is unforeseen that we didn't plan for. And as a result, medical debt postpones other financial goals like, well, all the things we've talked about in this class, right? Things like building an emergency fund, saving for future purchases, paying for education, investing for retirement. Hey, and if we can't make the payments in a reasonable fashion, sometimes beyond our control. What happens if that medical debt gets turned over to collections, right? Remember all the discussion we had about credit history, credit score, and the impact of bankruptcy on our credit? Yeah, this is a huge issue in the United States. And so here in the United States, what should we know? Statistically, about half the adults in the United States, about 150 million people here in the United States, have health insurance and have health insurance through their employer, an employer-sponsored health plan. That has traditionally been the way that most adults and most families have secured health insurance historically, through their employer. And about 62 million more people get health insurance through Medicaid and another 42 million through Medicare. We'll talk about what's the difference between those two programs a little later in this deck. About 22 million people appear to be getting their insurance through some combination of the Affordable Care Act with its exchanges and marketplaces and other similar types of ways of getting private insurance. And about 30 million people are still uninsured in the United States, if we are reading the data correctly. So that just sort of gives you an idea statistically how this all works out, right? Now, as we've mentioned before, right, why employer-sponsored insurance? Because the group plan takes advantage of risk pooling and therefore overall renders lower premium costs to both the employer and the employee, and the employer picks up a pretty large chunk of that premium in many, many cases. And so the pros of employer-sponsored insurance, well, the employer usually splits the premium with you. The sign-up is usually pretty easy. And premium payments are typically not taxed. You're making your portion of the premium payment pre-tax, which lowers your taxable income. That's a very significant benefit, especially given the cost of health insurance these days. But the downside of employer-sponsored health insurance, if you lose your job, well, now you got a problem. You've only got 60 days to switch to either a marketplace, or you might lose your insurance, or you might have to pay COBRA, which is incredibly expensive, which is taking on the full burden of the premium, which leads to getting stuck in a job that you hate. Many folks, they hate every part of their job except the medical health insurance benefits, and so they're stuck in a dead-end job they hate simply to hang on for the health insurance. And if you do take your employer-sponsored health insurance, you typically have not a whole lot of flexibility to choose your health plan, your health provider, the doctors, the hospital that would work best for you and your situation. But for many folks, especially financially, the pros outweigh the cons. And so if you do find yourself in a position to take advantage of employer-offered health benefits, that's oftentimes a very, very significant benefit that employers will offer to their employees. If not, you may need to turn to the Affordable Care Act enacted exchanges or marketplaces to find a way to get private insurance. And so the Affordable Care Act has put in place several methods for comparison shopping for health insurance, where private companies list their health plans and consumers can compare and shop. You got to note, though, when we talk about exchanges and marketplaces, we are not talking about your actual health insurance plan. It's just a method to find private insurance, right? Which in some cases may be partially subsidized by the government, but in many cases is not. Now, when we talk about exchanges and marketplaces, about 15 states, including California, run their own exchange. So you may have heard commercials or ads for Covered California. That is the marketplace that the state of California runs on their own. 24 states don't run their own exchange. They use the federally run exchange, healthcare.gov, and the rest of the states use some sort of a hybrid. Nevertheless, when you go and turn to the Affordable Care Act's marketplace or exchange to find your options for private medical insurance, what are some of the factors that impact your premium on the exchange? Well, there's several. You can see them here, right? Your age, where you live, whether or not you have used tobacco, whether you're looking for an individual or a family coverage plan, and then the type or the amount of coverage you want to purchase. And those are typically categorized into four tiers named after precious metals. So you have the platinum plan or the gold plan or the silver plan or the bronze plan. So every single one of those plans, no matter what metal tier or level of coverage you get, they, by law, have to cover at least these 10 essentials. You see them here, right? They have to cover outpatient care. They have to cover emergency services, as well as hospitalization. Every one of the plans has coverage for pregnancy, maternity, and newborn care. For mental health and substance use disorders, for prescription drugs, for rehabilitative and habilitative services and devices, for lab services, preventative and wellness services, as well as pediatric care. Now, the full extent and the limits of that coverage will vary by plan, but they have to at least cover those 10 categories. Now, how do we understand these different tiers or metal names? You can see it right here, right? You see the four major types of plans, platinum, gold, silver, and bronze, listed from the lowest price tag to the highest. You see that in the far right column. And essentially what you're saying is that for the higher the price tag, the more coverage the plan provides. You can see the platinum tier, the most expensive type of plan. The plan pays 90% of your medical expenses, you pay 10%. And then, of course, as you work your way down, your percentage that you have to pay out of pocket increases from 10 to 20, 20 to 30, 30 to 40% if you purchase a bronze plan, which will have the lowest premium amount. However, it will also have the highest amount of your self-contribution. The plan only pays 60% of your medical expenses. Now, still, you may say, okay, I think I sort of understand the differences in individual plans. What are the overall costs compared to an employer-sponsored plan? That's what we're showing you here, right? So in the top half of the slide, you see employer-sponsored health insurance, the average annual premium cost for one person. You can see there, the employee contributes $1,400. That's a year. The employer contributes almost $5,000, and therefore the total annual premium, $6,300, about $6,400, right? Of which the employee on an annual basis is only contributing about $1,400. which, you know, you do the math, that's less than $300 a month. Versus individual health coverage, the average annual premium cost for one person with a marketplace health plan, the average annual premium is about $7,300. And that's obviously a very significant increase on the annualized basis. The average annual premium among consumers receiving premium tax credit, oh, there you go, that's in the $300 neighborhood of the employer-sponsored health insurance, right? So in other words, the marketplace really does make sense if you qualify for the premium tax credit. If not, it's really expensive. Something to keep in mind as you do your comparison shopping, perhaps on Covered California. All right. Well, from there we get to, remember we talked about 100 million folks getting insurance through Medicare and Medicaid. What are those two plans? They are government-sponsored, government-funded plans, but they are very, very different. You can see there, Medicare is a national program generally for folks who are 65 and older, and also includes younger people with disability status, as well as people with ALS or Lou Gehrig's disease. It's funded by payroll deductions and federal taxes, but generally is known primarily as a federally funded program for seniors. Medicaid, on the other hand, is both funded by federal and state tax funds and generally provides health care costs for some folks with limited income and resources. It is income qualified. And so very, very different plans, both offered by the federal government. Now, this is not intended, of course, as a full-blown class on health insurance, right? This is just to give you a broad brush introduction to the topic. And you really, if you are in the market for health insurance, you really do need to talk to someone who's a professional to really go through all the specifics on how this may work for you and perhaps you and your family, you and your loved ones, if that's who you're looking to purchase insurance for. Health insurance is changing. The Affordable Care Act, well, it hasn't really impacted an enormous number of Americans when you look at the vast majority of folks who are have always received their health insurance through employee-sponsored sources. Nevertheless, it is a significant move in the right direction. And we hope that soon the whole idea of having 30 million Americans without any medical insurance at all, that is in our rearview mirror, but more work needs to be done. But we do hope that as you consider this module, obviously there's a whole lots of different types of insurance we haven't even talked about here, right? We haven't talked about life insurance. We haven't talked about disability insurance. There's a lot of stuff we haven't covered here, but hopefully this gives you some basic fundamental concepts to understand how insurance works and at least some of the major considerations for the big policies that you really should think about in your life from the purview of financial protection. Right? Renters or homeowners insurance, automobile insurance, and health insurance. Those are the real big categories of things that you need to consider as you think about personal finance and financial planning. I hope that's helpful. We'll see you in the next module.